Okay, let's see what else can we say on the light of this. So let's look to a term that maybe you're already familiar with it, which is the elastic potential. So far we have defined something. The energy that matters for us is the internal energy. Remember that we defined internal energy, which was a part due to the stress power and a part due to the thermal power, right? And we just brought in global form the question of energy, saying that any variation of this internal energy, this U that now stands for the specific internal energy, so the internal energy per unit of mass, if I multiply times rho, by the way, look that I have placed here rho zero, just emphasizing that the density in this theory is constant. So it's no longer unknown. So rho zero stands for the initial density at every point, but initial, that doesn't vary a long time. So we know that. But anyway, this is then, that integration is the full internal energy. The variation about time is the stress power plus the term due to the heat variation. That's what the equation that at the global level we arrived at in the previous chapter. Look, now I can enter this differential with respect to time here. Look, now B is the domain of integration that is not varying a long time because we are in the infinitesimal strain theory. So B doesn't depend on T, and just taking derivatives is just taking derivatives of the kernel. So just we enter that into the kernel, and that is what we have. And here we have that. And look, this part here is precisely the heat entering into the medium. And since we are assuming so far that the process is adiabatic, then this term just is a mode, is negligible. So finally, since this term is negligible, we find that this differential of the total energy is equal to the stress power. So now the stress power is really an exact differential. So we can say that this stress power in this case, for the first time, gives rise to an energy, which is the internal energy, that differentiated with respect to time provides the power. This is not the general case, but in this case of adiabatic problems, which is the one that we are considering, it does. Okay. So, now we can localize. That's a process that we have done many times, since we assume that this is valid for any sub-portion of the domain V, then what is fulfilled at the integral level, when we have volume integrals, it's fulfilled in terms of points, so differential of this is equal to that. By the way, another simplification can be done in that case, because the rate of a strain tensor D, we already know that for the infinitesimal strain case, is exactly the rate, the differential with respect to time, of the infinitesimal strain. You know, this is the general case, but in that case, when epsilon, capital epsilon is equal to small epsilon, and F is approximately equal to one, then we arrive to that D is equal to epsilon dot, approximately equal. So this is what we have. That is the equation of the, that's the local form of the equation of the energy, the differential with respect to time of the density of energy is equal to sigma times epsilon dot, which by the way we can identify as the work which is done at that point by the stresses per unit of time when they are deforming the element, okay? And that is what in this elastic theory gives rise to what we call the elastic potential. Why the name potential here? Well, you will see. Let's, for simplification, from now on, instead of dealing with the specific density, specific internal energy, which is the energy per unit of mass, we'll talk about the density of energy. So the density per unit of volume. So we pass from that to this by multiplying by the density. So we obtain that differential of this u hat with respect to time is sigma times epsilon dot. Well, let's see what happens when we replace sigma by C times epsilon, that is the constitutive equation. So we have that this differential is epsilon C epsilon dot. And after some operations here, I won't go to the details of that, but just take into account precisely the symmetries that we can change indices because of the symmetries, major and minor symmetries of that. We arrive to the conclusion that this differential of u respect to t, which is sigma times epsilon dot, when replacing c times epsilon he, becomes 1/2 of the differential with respect to t of 1/2 of epsilon c epsilon. Okay? Well, that says something. See, now this allows us identifying what is this u, because we have differential with respect to t of something is differential with respect to t of something. So these two entities should differ in something which is just a constant in terms of space and in terms of time. Okay? So we'll talk about that. That is what we've done. And the consequences of that are the following. First, the one that I've already mentioned. Now the stress power is already gives rise to an energy. Which is the energy associated to this power? The internal energy. Okay? And this, in our cases, in elastic materials, this is called the deformation energy. Deformation energy is nothing else than the internal energy in strain in elastic materials. In other materials, there are some other components, but in elastic materials, deformation, what you call, and maybe you remember from your elasticity courses, the deformation energy is just the elastic energy. Second, that internal energy, either the macro, the global, or the local, is an exact differential. Okay? So this can be integrated. Okay? So we can integrate that equation and say, well, if differential of u, which is a function of space and time, with respect to time, is the differential of this with respect to time, then u is this plus some function that doesn't depend on time, which is a function of the point. Okay? And that constant is irrelevant for our purposes. So we assume that this constant is zero. So at zero, why? That's equivalent to assume that this internal energy at the reference configuration is zero. If that, when we specify at port equal zero, when the strains are zero, then we find that the reference configurations, when the strains are zero, this term became A, and A is zero. So by assuming that this internal energy, or this strain energy, or this deformation energy, is equal to zero at the reference configuration, which is just a boundary condition, so to speak, to determine this constant, we just can finally come up with the equation that the internal energy, the strain energy, the deformation energy in an elastic material is so in that case, the internal energy, the density of internal energy, is 1/2 of epsilon c epsilon. But since c epsilon is sigma, this gives rise to that other alternative. The internal energy is 1/2 of the stresses that depend on epsilon through the constitutive equation, times double dot product, the strains. Okay? And we can say something else that we can exploit, that tensor C, due to thermodynamic reasons, is assumed to be a positive definite tensor. The concept of positive definiteness, maybe are you familiar with that? We say that a quantity, a scalar quantity, is positive if that quantity multiplied by x squared, where x squared is any number, is zero. That's the definition. So if a quantity A or C times x squared is zero, a scalar quantity, yeah? Times x squared is zero for any x squared, what can we say about C? That's for x squared different from zero, for any x different from zero, we can say about C that C is positive. So this is extended to from scalars to second order tensors to fourth order tensors. So in a fourth order tensor, this quantity C is said to be positive definite if when double dot multiplied by and left and right by any value e different from zero, it's positive. That's what is fulfilled by the constant elastic tensor. And this comes up, I'm not going to that, to thermodynamic reasons that can be related also to the second principle of thermodynamics. Okay? So, well, this is the elastic potential, and now we can go to the justification that why do we call it potential? Well, if now we have identified the elastic potential was in terms of the strains as 1/2 of epsilon C epsilon, C is a constant, C is a constant tensor, doesn't depend on the strains. So now we can differentiate this elastic potential with respect to epsilon. So when we differentiate that, well, the rules can be obtained also by doing index notation, but the rules are similar to the ones that we have. If we have differentiate the first, that part here, C times epsilon, time with respect to epsilon. And this belongs, it gives C, so this C times epsilon, then we differentiate with respect to this epsilon, we obtain epsilon C, and due to the symmetry, C times epsilon is equal to epsilon C, which, by the way, are equal to sigma, so this is sigma transpose, which is sigma. So finally, differentiation of this U, the internal energy, the density of internal energy, returns the stresses. That is the property. So we have found that the internal energy in an elastic material has this form. But then, as a consequence, if we differentiate the internal energy with respect to the strains, we obtain the stresses. Okay? In fact, I can tell you that this is the relevant property of elastic materials. So this property still holds for nonlinear materials. Of course, for linear materials, we have found that this property holds. But if the material are not elastic, what characterizes a material, nonlinear, sorry, what characterizes elastic materials is the fact that there exists a potential, a function of the strains, and a scalar function of the strains, which differentiated with respect to the strains, are return the stresses. Okay? So that is what qualifies the most important family of elastic materials, even in nonlinear cases, that the stresses come from a potential. You remember that I call you about what the potential function is, right? We have seen that in vectors. We get that a vector field was a potential if the gradient derivative of the if that vector field could be obtained of a gradient with respect to the space of a scalar field. So this is the extension to that. That scalar vector function of the stresses is a potential function for the stresses, because by differentiation with respect to the strains, we obtain the stresses. Okay? Second, let's differentiate again that twice. So let's differentiate the stresses, which depend on the strains, with respect to the strains. Look, maybe you are now a little shocked because I'm here differentiated with respect to strains, so with respect to tensor, and I differentiation twice with respect to tensor. Well, in order to differentiate that function with respect to one tensor, one entity, which is a function of some other entity, with respect to that entity, just we have to differentiate that every component of this with every component of that. Okay? So that's what we did here. So the differentiation of every component of U with respect to epsilon, which is sigma ij, is differential of U with respect epsilon ij. If I now differentiate with respect any component again to do that, then is differential with epsilon kl. So this is a fourth order tensor, because I have differentiated with respect to U with respect to epsilon ij, U with respect to epsilon kl. So there are four indices here. And by the way, this four order tensor is due to the replacing here C times epsilon is nothing else than the elastic constitutive tensor. So finally, we find that for these elastic materials, the derivative of the stresses with respect to the strain is constant. Look, this is nothing else that an extension of what we have here. How would you say, what would we say is the differential of the stresses with respect to the strains in this equation? What is it? The constant, no? If I differentiate that with respect to that, that is the constant, okay? So now we obtain that, again, this can be generalized to the case in which the stresses differentiated with respect to the strains return the tangent constitutive operator, okay?